Good morning. Welcome to Mountain Church. It's Super Bowl Sunday, apparently. Any Patriot fans out there? Yeah? Any Eagle fans out there? Any fans of any team that plays against the Patriots? That would be me. So go Eagles. Anyway, would you guys stand? And then we're going to ask the Lord to bless our time this morning. Father, thank you so much for all that you do in our lives. Thank you for a new day full of mercy and grace. Thank you for a new day where we get to grow in our understanding of you, where we get to grow in our faith. For another day where we get to lean upon you and trust in you. Another day where we get to hear from you and where we get to be exposed to your goodness. And so we come together here as a family, as a church family, and we know that we are in a good place and that we are in a safe place because we are not in a place that we will find condemnation or judgment, that we can come to you with who we are and with our struggles and with our hearts open before you, and that you do not judge us, you do not condemn us, but you show us your love and your grace. And so would you pour that out upon us this morning as we begin in worshiping you and singing songs of praise to you, and as we serve you together, Father, as we give to you, as your word is open, I pray that you would speak to our hearts in a powerful way, that we would be encouraged in you. And we just thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Chris has some announcements for us, so here you go, Chris.
Good morning, church. Good looking group out here, especially this section right there. So hey, I got a couple announcements for you. For those of you that came here on Super Bowl Sunday, great job. You guys get a little gold star from me, so wear that home with pride. We've got inductive study with question and answer periods. It's Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. It's an in-depth study of the who, what, when, where, and why of a particular book or anything that we're studying that in today's day and age, we tend to take one verse or one scripture, and sometimes it can be misapplied to our lives in a couple different ways. So getting into the inductive study is really learning who was there, why it was written, who is it intended to reach, and why. Things that we can be deeply rooted in so that when we hear different things in our lives that we're like, that doesn't sound right. Why does it not sound right? Well, that's because we've done our homework and done a really deep inductive study, and we can do that with Jim Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. So if you're missing this, you're missing a lot. We've got Mountain Church Camp coming up, Sunset Bay Campground, June 21st through the 23rd. Flyer looks like this. You can pick that up in the lobby at the front desk. So sign up for that. That's coming up again this summer, June 21st through the 23rd. And last but not least, we've got Easter prep coming up. Doesn't that sound great? I know everybody likes Easter service, but we can actually prep and help the guys around here, mostly Jason and I. You can help us prep the grounds for our Easter service. So what we're going to do is pull out some irrigation. We're going to be doing some new irrigation for the tree line around here. We're going to be doing some annual flowers front and back, some bark mulch, things like that. I'll show you how to do it, but please do sign up at the desk, because if you don't, then it'll just be Jason and I out there by ourselves, and there's a lot of it. So even if you can pick up a shovel, we'd appreciate you having you showing up. So the dates are at the desk, and help us out. Sign up right over there. That's all I got for you today. So as we get ready to worship the Lord, let's just turn around and say hi to somebody.
but everything we could ever give, Lord. Thank you for bringing us together again today. You guys can be seated. We're going to continue worshiping today with the giving of the tithes and the offerings.
Your name.
for this last one.
So we offer these songs up to you. We offer our lives to you this morning, Father. For you are a good God and a gracious God, worthy of praise. And we know that in this country, across the world today, that there will be many people who will be shouting and screaming and yelling, and many of us doing the same perhaps, Lord. But we know that you alone are worthy of worship. So may we have that in proper perspective today as we enjoy friends and fellowship and enjoy a game, but may we also be mindful of your greatness. As great as any one team or one athlete can be, you are better. You are greater. And so we gather here today because of that. We want to hear from you. We want to learn from you. Father, would you speak to us? As your word is opened, would you teach us of your goodness? Would you teach us of your might? And may we learn of your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can be seated. And we have a special guest speaker this morning, someone from within the church family, Dr. Dan Fidler. And I have known Dr. Dan for a long time. Yes, there was some confusion last service. We do have two Dr. Dans here at the church. There's Dr. Dan Fidler and Dr. Dan Tomlinson. But I have known both of them for a long time. But Dr. Dan and I connect on many different levels. He's a little older than I am, but he used to watch some of the football and basketball games that I would play in as a kid in high school. And then we would talk as his kids started playing basketball. And I think by the time they were six or seven, they were taller than me. So therefore they were much more successful at basketball. But we would connect on sports and all those things. But also we connected because he has a passion for Jesus. And he began teaching the kids in our church. And as a youth minister at the time, we would get together, me and the other guys, and we would talk about this gift that Dan has, Dan and his wife Carol, how they would be able to talk to people about God, to communicate the gospel of Jesus Christ in a really powerful way. And we were learning from them at that time. And so I know that you guys are going to be blessed this morning. We're going to be blessed to hear from Dr. Dan as he opens the word this morning. So would you please welcome Dan Fidler.
Good morning. Thank you guys for all coming on Super Bowl Sunday. Good to be here with you today. And you know, it's funny how things work out. There is a clear sports theme through the passage of Scripture we'll be looking at today on Super Bowl Sunday. It's great how that worked out. It's not something I'm reading into the passage, or you might think because you and Ryan are sports guys, that's what's going on. But it's in the original Greek. There's no doubt about it. So we're going to have some fun with some little bit of sports stuff tonight from the book of Hebrews. So I have really loved going through the book of Hebrews and tracking along as Jim and Ryan have been teaching us through that. Hope you guys have enjoyed it as much as I have. Quick little refresher, the author of Hebrews is writing to a church that has grown up in Judaism. They've been steeped in the tradition of Judaism. This letter was written probably about 60 AD, definitely before 70 AD. He's writing to people, some of them were around when Jesus was on the earth, when he was put on trial and crucified and the resurrection. So these guys had grown up in Judaism. They knew all about the history of Judaism. They knew about Moses and Aaron and Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the laws and the sacrifices and the rituals that the high priest would do and the tabernacle. And so when this author is writing to them, he uses words they understand and things that are important, illustrations they know to make sure he communicates clearly. And this church was at a point where they're thinking about walking away from Jesus. They had grown up in Judaism. They had seen Jesus. Some of them were there when Jesus was on the earth. They had seen what happened. They watched his resurrection. They were solid believers. They decided, we're going to leave Judaism. We're all in with Jesus. We're tracking with Jesus. And their hope and trust was in Jesus. They were living a life with the Lord, but then life got tough because they started getting harassed. And then it went from harassment to persecution. And then they were beaten for believing in Jesus. And then some of them were thrown in prison for their faith in Jesus Christ. So they started to think, maybe we should leave Jesus behind and go back to what we knew of our Jewish traditions. Maybe we should leave Jesus behind and go find some other person to follow, some other spiritual leader. They're tempted to leave Jesus behind. And this is what this author is going to address clearly and definitively in his letter to the folks in the book of Hebrews. It reminds me of an important time in my family. It was kind of a momentous time in my family. We were moving from Iowa, where I had been for 4 years of training, and we were coming to the Rogue Valley, and we were so excited about it. We had been pumping up our kids and talking to our boys about how cool it was going to be in Oregon and in the Rogue Valley with the Rogue River running through it and mountains and trees and close to the coast and great climate, and they wouldn't have to deal with all these foot of snow we would get in Iowa in the long, cold winters. And my boys were so excited about moving to Oregon. Well, a week before we were supposed to move, our daughter made her arrival. She was supposed to come couple weeks earlier. So we had 1 week in Iowa with the newest member of our family. And we brought her home, and we had a pretty good first week with our daughter in our home in Iowa. We were organizing and packing and getting ready to go. loading up our vehicle, which was then a Chevy Impala squad car. It was from a fleet made for the state patrol. It was a blue, beat-up old Chevy Impala with 130,000 miles, but it was going to be reliable to get us across the country. So we get all set to go. Our boys had loved the first week with their sister. She was a great baby. She was doing great at home. We get in the car, and we start heading to Oregon. Any of you who have traveled with a baby that's a week old might have known what was coming. We were a little naive in this deal, but we thought she was happy at home. She'll be fine in the car, and it did not work that way. She made it about an hour, maybe 2 hours every day, and then the crying started, and it continued, and it continued. And there was nothing we could do to console her, to get her out of the car seat, feed her, change her, hold her, whatever it was. She was just going to yell the rest of the way. My boys, they're sitting and talking in the back seat and conspiring with each other, as they frequently did. And pretty soon we hear from the back seat, "Mom, Dad, can we ask you something?" We said, "Sure." They said, "Well, we really love our sister. She's a very sweet baby and all, but she was a lot happier in Iowa, and we don't think she wants to move to Oregon. She's not very excited about this move to Oregon. So we know there's lots of families in Iowa who would like a baby, and maybe we could leave her with a family that wants a baby, and then we could move to Oregon, and everybody would be happy. A family in Iowa would be happy. Our sister would be happy. We'd be in Oregon, and we can have another baby sister in Oregon who wants to be there. It'll be great." And while I was busy biting my cheeks and trying not to laugh too hard, my wife lovingly explained that, hey, this is a family for life. It's no family member left behind, right? No baby left behind policy in this family. And that they would grow to love her sister and would really appreciate her being part of the family. They just needed to bear with this. It's just a tough time. You can get through it. We're not going to leave the family. And that's what was going on with this book of Hebrews too. Now, in my boys' defense, I will say they weren't saying throw her out the window or leave her at the rest stop and abandon her, right? They wanted her with a good family. And in my daughter's defense, no one-week-old baby is very happy about riding 8 hours a day in a car across the country. So you can blame that mostly on the parents' decision. But such as it is, this is what the book of Hebrews is going to address. The writer is saying, you guys are thinking about leaving Jesus behind just to go back to what it was or make your life more convenient. And that's not a great idea. So the next snippet from my family that relates to this is 2 years later. Fast forward 2 years, we're in Oregon. We're in Southern Oregon. We're loving the Rogue Valley. But our squad car is about to give it up. It's now over 150,000 miles, and the steel belts are fraying through the tires, and mechanically it's getting a little less than reliable. So my wife and I did the research. We analyzed the situation. We did the calculations, looked and see what would be a good vehicle for Southern Oregon, for a family of five and frequent visitors and the kids' friends riding with us, and we wanted to be able to have four-wheel drive over the ice and the mountains and in the valleys and all. So we bought a white Suburban, right? And the kids were pretty emotionally attached to that old blue squad car. It was hard for them to part with it. It was a dear friend of theirs, but they finally grudgingly gave in and sat in the Suburban, and I traded the squad car in. But what would have happened if a month later I went back to the dealership and said, you know, there's some things I really don't like about this Suburban. It guzzles way too much gas. It only gets like 12 or 13 miles to the gallon. I have to fill it up way more often than my old squad car. And it's white, so when I go through storms and messy days, I have to get out and wash it. And I don't want to be washing my car all the time. And besides that, it's so big to park. When I'm in Medford and trying to find a parking place in a lot or on the streets, it's hard to park. So this is a pretty inconvenient car. I want my squad car back. Can you just give me my old one back? I want to go back to the way things were. I was familiar, and it was easy for me. Now, if I had a car dealer who was a person of integrity and an honest man, there's a few of those around here. I've met a couple in my life. They would tell me, "Are you crazy?" And he would sit down with me and say, "Let's do a side-by-side comparison. Let's look at your 150-mile beat-up old squad car versus this new Suburban. The Suburban has higher ratings in the city and higher ratings for safety on the highway. It handles better. It's going to keep your family safer if someone runs into you. When you're going over the tops of the mountains when there's ice on the road, it's got four-wheel drive. You didn't have that before. And apart from all that, Just look at the value. If you just do an assessment of the worth and value of this vehicle, you'd be nuts to trade it straight up for your old car, just to go back to something's familiar for your convenience. You really shouldn't do that. And that's what the author of Hebrews is telling this group of Christians. Hey, you've got Jesus. He is worth far more, of far more surpassing worth and value. Don't go back to the old stuff just because it's familiar. Stick with Jesus. And he's going to do, just like this car salesman would do, a side-by-side comparison and take them through lots of passages through the Old Testament to prove the superiority and the absolute supremacy of Jesus. He starts in Hebrews 1, verse 1. And if you've been tracking with Hebrews, you followed some of this with us. In the very first verse of Hebrews, he says, God has spoken in many ways over the years. May he's spoken through creation. He's spoken through prophets. But the very best way that God has revealed himself to us, his best revelation, his best communication, is in his son Jesus, because Jesus is the exact representation of the Father. So the revelation of God, his communication, is better through Jesus. And then he just goes on, boom, boom, boom. Angels are great. Jesus is way better than angels. Moses, he was a great leader. He took our people out of Egypt and got us to the edge of the promised land, but he couldn't go in the promised land. Jesus is better than Moses. And he goes on to Joshua. Well, Joshua got us in the promised land, but he didn't really give us the rest that was there. Jesus is far superior to Joshua. Aaron, good high priest, the first high priest of the people of Israel. But he had to do the sacrifices over and over and over and over. And Jesus did a sacrifice once for all. Jesus is superior to Aaron. He's better than Aaron. And he keeps going through. The law would make nothing perfect. But there's a better hope with Jesus. The sacrifice of Jesus, it was once for all. Way better than previously priestly sacrifices that had to go over and over, day after day, year after year. The true tabernacle in heaven where Jesus is seated at the right hand of God is far better than the model of the tabernacle that we had here on earth. Jesus is better than the whole system of the Old Testament priesthood. God's law is written on our heart. That's way better than written on tablets of stone, the Ten Commandments in the Old Testament. The blood of bulls and goats could only just cover sins temporarily. The blood of Jesus, far better than the blood of bulls and goats with sacrifices. In heaven, the place we can go because of Jesus, it's a better country than even the promised land of the Old Testament. The new covenant mediated by the blood of Jesus, it's better than the old covenant. Over and over and over again, side-by-side comparison, showing how Jesus is better. The absolute superiority of Jesus Christ. It would be a resounding proof to that church, these guys who knew Judaism and who had seen what happened. They weren't hearing stories hundreds of years later. They were there when Jesus was crucified and resurrected. They knew the facts, and he's showing it would be way, way better to stick with Jesus. Well, that's been our theme through the first part of the book of Hebrews. Jesus is better. The book of better things, and Jesus is best of all. But as you look at that, we move from there onto a part called endurance. And we've talked about the theme of the second part of the book of Hebrews being enduring in the life of faith. One of my favorite Bible teachers, R.C. Sproul, great theologian, great Bible teacher. He recently was promoted to heaven in December 2017. He went to be with the Lord. I heard a teaching from him on Hebrews once where he said, if I had only one book of the whole Bible, if my Bible was reduced to one book, and that's all I had to study, to learn, to teach from, it would be the book of Hebrews, because it summarizes the whole Old Testament. It tells me what all this coming out of Egypt and sacrifice and the law and the prophets and the priests and all these rites and rituals were about. They're all pointing to Jesus. And it tells me, it interprets the actions of Jesus, what he did when he was on earth, his death for us, his voluntarily being a sacrifice and shedding his blood. It puts the whole Bible in context and in perspective. If there was only one book, R.C. Sproul says, it's Hebrews. Give me that book, and that's the summary of the whole message of the scripture. So it's great to go through it. It's so exciting. We've moved on to the Hebrews 11 Hall of Faith the last few weeks when Ryan and Jim have been taking us through that. One of the things that really strikes me as we're kind of looking back the last few weeks on Hebrews 11 is that these guys that are lifted up as models of faith, these characters from the Old Testament, they kind of goofed up sometimes. They made some mistakes, and we've been kind of spotlighting a few of their lives lately. And you look at Abraham, father of faith, right? Great example of faith. He kind of gave his wife away a couple times to protect his own skin and said, she's my sister. And his wife Sarah was taken into the harem of first Pharaoh and later a guy named Abimelech. And you think, that's not really a very virtuous move for someone who's supposed to be in the hall of faith, right? And then we moved on to Jacob, and Jacob was a trickster, a swindler, kind of a con man who cheated his brother out of birthright and blessing and was swindling his uncle Laban and trying to make every deal work better for him. Chronic, classic con man. And then we moved to David, great king, wrote the Psalms, great worship leader, but he was also an adulterer and conspired in the murder of Bathsheba. What is he doing in the hall of faith? What's this about? And Samson is listed there, chronic womanizer, right? He would chase anything in a skirt from any nation, even if it's a Philistine girl who's one of the enemies of Israel. Kind of reminds you of some of our politicians and stuff lately. And then you had Rahab, who came out of a life of prostitution to track with Israel and repent and go with God's people. And you look at that and you say, why are these guys in the hall of faith? What is that about? And if you have been tracking with us, there's a couple verses in Hebrews that completely explain this. Hebrews chapter 8, the Lord says, quoting the prophet Jeremiah, I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. Hebrews 10, their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. So these guys made mistakes, but they repented, they sought the Lord, they were living a life of faith, they're tracking along with God, walking in his ways. And what the Lord says is, hey, if you've repented and changed direction, you're walking my path, your sins are blotted out, they're forgiven, they're wiped off the hard drive, totally gone, and I don't remember them anymore. I'm only remembering the good things you have done for me and your service to me and your faithfulness. That's why these guys are in the hall of faith. And in my mind, I'm thinking, now wait a minute. There's a baseball hall of fame. There's other sports hall of fames. We're on sports weekends here, Super Bowl weekend. Let's look at the baseball hall of fame and compare that to the Hebrews hall of faith, right? Pete Rose, great baseball player, leading hit guy in all of baseball. He bet on baseball. Boom, lifetime ban. He's out of baseball. He's not in the hall of fame. What about Barry Bonds, greatest home run hitter of all time? He was juiced, man. He was cheating. He was sinning. He was breaking the rules and using steroids. He's not in the Baseball Hall of Fame. Sammy Sosa, Mark McGwire, great stars, home run hitters recently. They're not in the Hall of Fame. They're excluded because of their errors and sins. Roger Clemens, maybe the greatest pitcher of all time. So many no-hitters, pitched for different teams all over the place. Texas, the Yankees, great athlete, great pitcher. Performance-enhancing drugs. He broke the rules. He sinned. He is not in the Baseball Hall of Fame. So what's going on? How come these guys, for relatively minor offenses, right? They didn't kill anybody. They weren't giving their wives away and to protect their own skin. They weren't in a life of chronic promiscuity like Samson or prostitution like Rahab. How come these guys are excluded for life from the Baseball Hall of Fame? But Hebrews 11, these guys are in our hall of faith. Well, God has told us he has forgiven our sins and they are forgotten. They're wiped off the hard drive. It reminds me of when Jesus was put before this woman caught in adultery in John chapter 8. They brought this woman caught in the act of adultery. They put her before Jesus and they say, Jesus, our law says to stone her. What do you say we should do with her? And Jesus kind of individually deals with the people who are accusing her and they all leave. And Jesus asks the woman, hey, where are your accusers? Does no man condemn you? And she says, there's no one here, Lord. No one's condemning me. And Jesus says, I don't condemn you either. Now, go your way and sin no more. He doesn't say, keep going in your life of sin. It's okay. Every sin's forgiven. I'm a good guy, so just do whatever you want and you'll still get to heaven. He says, your sins can be forgiven. Go your way. Sin no more. You don't need to stay in a lifestyle of sin. You don't need to stay as a slave or a servant to sin. Serve the Lord. Follow after me. You don't need that life of sin. We're not to promote sin, ignore sin, lead others into sin. But if you, like me, have sinned in the past and made mistakes, maybe some big errors in your life in the past, maybe there's some stuff you would love to be able to rewind the tape and do differently, guess what? You are forgiven. The sin is forgotten if you're tracking with the Lord and walking with him. It's off the hard drive, and the Lord is looking down and just tallying up the good stuff you're doing for him and your acts of faith and what you're doing in his name. And those are all tallies for you as you count up your votes for the Hall of Fame. You're not ineligible. I'm not ineligible. We can be in the Hall of Faith just like these characters from Hebrews 11. And that's so encouraging to me. Tonight, We're moving from Hebrews 11, which has been a great study, to Hebrews 12, one of my favorite passages in the Bible. So we're going to read it together in just a minute, but I'm going to pause for just a moment of prayer first. Lord, we thank you for this passage that speaks so clearly to us from Hebrews 12. And today, Lord, we would ask that your Spirit would bring your truth through your word to your church here today as we seek to learn from you. In the name of your Son, Jesus, amen. So on the screen for you will be Hebrews 12, verses 1 to 3. This happens to be NIV. You could do this passage and study it and read it in any translation, and it would be awesome and inspirational. But today it's NIV, and if you don't mind, I'd like to all read it together as something that's really empowering to me to hear God's people reading the scripture together. So read with me here, Hebrews 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders us and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Okay, amen. You can go home. It's such a powerful passage. We could stop right there. But let's look at it a little bit more before we run out the door today. Let's start with Hebrews 12, verse 1. Therefore is what it starts with. So when you hear therefore, you've got to see what it's there for. And look what before it. It refers back to what was right before this. So in considering the superiority of Jesus, how he is so much better than any other option that we're following in life, and the importance of a life of faith and all these characters and heroes of faith we've just been studying in Hebrews 11. Based on all that we've just been talking about, how should we live our life? What should we do? How should we be walking the Christian walk or running the race of life, as this analogy is? Well, we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, referring to all those heroes of faith brought up in Hebrews 11. Maybe some family members of yours have already been in heaven and they may be looking down at your life. And what he's saying is, you got VIPs watching how you live your life. And I'll speak as a former athlete. Present athlete is way, way long ago, years gone for me. But when I was playing basketball in high school or college, if someone told me, hey, you got a cloud of witnesses here today, and Michael Jordan's up in the stands to watch you play. And by the way, there's Magic Johnson up there and Larry Bird. And nowadays it might include Steph Curry or LeBron James or Kevin Durant or some of these guys. And they'd say, okay, go out and play your game now. There's some VIPs watching. How do you think I would play as an athlete? What would I be motivated to do? Do you think I'd be dogging it on the court, loafing, lazy? I would want to be playing my very best because I've got a VIP audience right there watching me play. Or if I'm a quarterback, since we're on Super Bowl week, if I'm a high school quarterback and the game's about to start and someone nudges me and says, hey, look up in the stands. There's Joe Montana. He heard you were here today, and he wanted to watch you play. Oh, and Steve Young's there, and, it's an off week for some of the NFL teams. So Tom Brady's up there and Carson Wentz from the Eagles. Some of these great quarterbacks are here to watch you play. How do you think that would make me feel if I was a quarterback? I would want to be on the top of my game, right? Nailing every call, reading the defense, making every pass and every handoff just right. I'd want to have it dialed in because I've got VIPs watching me. And this is what this writer is saying here in Hebrews. You have some VIPs watching your life every day, how you're living your life, what you're doing day by day, week by week. So make it count. Make it count. Don't be goofing off and making poor decisions and be lazy how you're living your life. You got a great cloud of witnesses, so let's do our best. Next, it says we're going to throw off everything that hinders us. Hebrews 12:1. We throw off every weight or anything that's hindering us, any extra weight. Some of you may wonder what this is about and why all this sports stuff is going on. What's with all these sports analogies? Before we get to the weight and stuff, why are we talking about sports? Is it just because I'm a sports guy, Ryan's a sports guy? Is it because it's Super Bowl week and that's just orchestrated, or we schemed it to have it on this day? Didn't work that way, guys. We're going to talk a little bit about Olympic history today. And I know the Winter Olympics are coming up, not summer, but the Olympic Games started with Summer Olympics. So let's look at Olympic history. You guys may not know this number off the tip of your tongue, but 776 BC, first time there were Olympic Games. It was games in Greece. It was held in the Greek town of Olympia, hence the name Olympics. And to start with, there was only one event. It was a foot race. It was a sprint, about 200 meters, roughly 600 feet or so. And for the first 13 times the Olympics were held every 4 years, so over 52 years, that was the only event. It was a one-day Olympic competition, the big race, 200 meters, just running. But things changed with time. Over the next 400 years, the games were still only held in Olympia in Greece, but they added more and more events. Javelin was put in there, and then wrestling and boxing and longer races instead of just the 200 meter race, and horse racing was added, and later chariot racing was added. And because of all these extra events, it went from 1 day to 3 days to 5 day competition for the Olympics. Then we moved on to when Rome took over Greece, 146 BC. Romans are now eligible for the Olympics. Since Rome has conquered Greece, and the Olympic Games, instead of being an all-Greek event, are now Greco-Roman games, right? So Roman citizens are eligible to participate in the Olympics. And some of them became professional athletes. Their full-time job year-round was to train for the Olympics so they could compete for the glory of Rome in the Olympics. If you guys think our society is a little focused on professional athletes and too much on athleticism, blame the Romans. They started it way back, 146, professional athletes in Rome. And then in 4 BC, you may recognize this name, a dude named Tiberius. He was considered the Olympic champion that year because he won the chariot race. And that was the biggest event, the final event, and the last day of the Olympic Games was the chariot race. You may know the name because in Luke chapter 3, it says that when John the Baptist was baptizing and when he baptized Jesus, Tiberius was Caesar. So the emperor of the whole Roman Empire, Caesar Tiberius, was a guy who was into sports and was an Olympic chariot racer, a champion Olympic athlete. So sports was very big in the society, and that's why this author is putting this in as an analogy. These people would know it and understand it. 776 BC was the first Olympic Games. We're now at 60 AD, so for 800 years, athletic competition was a big deal, and there was a crowd of people there to watch a foot race to see who would be the winner, how could these guys run. So he's making this analogy of the Christian life as a race because they would understand it, especially in the setting of the Roman Empire. That was a big event. It's not just because I'm sports crazy. These are the actual Greek words used in the passage that this compare your life to running a race. So what are we supposed to do next? We're supposed to throw off every weight that might hold us down. And if you watch those Olympic races, some of you guys may have, like I did, watched Usain Bolt win gold medals lately, and you watch all these sprinters out there, right, in their 200-meter or 100-meter competition, how much extra weight do they have on their bodies? Man, close to nothing. There's companies like Nike that have made millions on trying to make clothing for track athletes as light as possible. Ultralight shorts, ultralight tank top, the lightest possible shoes, take away even an ounce or two from the weight that might give you an advantage as an athlete. And all these guys are running with as minimal weight as possible. Now, what would you say if you're watching an Olympic competition or a big track meet, and there's one guy who shows up saying, I'm pretty good, I'm faster than everybody else, so I'm gonna wear ankle weights just to prove I could win this event while I'm wearing extra ankle weights and a lead vest to weigh me down. Or I'm gonna do this sprint in hiking boots or in ski boots. You'd never see anything like that, right? If you want to win, you're going to cast off all the extra weight. Don't be running with extra weight in this race of life that we have before us. So what's the application for us? What kind of extra weight could be slowing us down in our Christian life? This is not referring to bad stuff or sins or mistakes. It's just extra stuff that we're trying to lug along, extra baggage that we don't need in our life. Maybe it's a relationship with a friend that you had from before you became a Christian, and that's pulling you down and slowing you down in your walk of life. And you know that you're not supposed to be mean to that person, but the more time you hang out with them and spend time with them, it's taking you away from your walk from the Lord. Maybe you need to put that baggage behind, that relationship or friendship. Maybe it's possessions and you're working so hard to get your bank account up or your retirement account or to get a new car, and the car is so important to you that you spend all your weekends polishing your car or doing extra work to get the greatest car instead of coming to church, serving the Lord, seeking after Him. So what this point of this is, whatever it is that is hindering us from our walk with the Lord, put it behind you. Don't carry extra baggage in the race. I mean, can you imagine Carl Lewis, a great American sprinter, or Usain Bolt showing up for a competition and bringing all their old gold medals just to show off and show how important they are? and trying to run with all the medals bouncing off their chest. Or maybe they'd put it in a carry bag, right? And Usain Bolt would be doing the 200-meter dash, dragging his little carry bag behind him, holding all his gold medals. Wouldn't happen. He'd have no chance of doing well. And that's what this is telling us. Don't let extra weight, anything that's hindering you from running your race of the life with God, put it behind. Leave it behind. So after the weight, what else should we do? We should also get rid of any sin, the sin that so easily entangles us. And if you look at this in the original language, it's not saying get rid of all sin. We'll never do that, or a sin or any sin. But for each of us, it seems there's one specific sin that we might be more susceptible to, that might keep tripping us up. And what it's saying is, if there's one habitual sin, a problem that keeps making you stumble in your walk with the Lord, deal with it. Don't just keep it going. It's like trying to run with your shoelaces tied together in a sprint. It's going to trip you up, take you down. Deal with the sin, talk to people, pray about it, talk to a pastor, get it beyond you. Don't let one habitual, chronic little sin keep you from running the race that God would have you to run. Next, after we've dealt with those things, we need to run with perseverance or endurance, as other translations have this word. Run the race marked out for us with endurance. And we've been talking about how Hebrews, Jesus is the best, Jesus is better than everything else, and then run with endurance. We need to run our race with endurance. Don't give up, don't fade. And to me, that takes me to a phrase that you guys have probably heard before, that if you're comparing the Christian life to a competition, the Christian life is not as much a sprint, like a 200-meter race, as it is a, what? A marathon, right? Usain Bolt won the last 200-meter, the world record event, 200-meter sprint in less than 20 seconds. It was like 19.2 seconds. So God is far more interested with what we do in our life than one 20-second little snippet, right? He wants to know that we're tracking with him over the long run. It's more like a marathon. That's a better analogy. And because of that, there is some really cool history with the marathon that just plays right into this passage and explains what's going on. So here we go with more sports stuff for Super Bowl week for you sports fans. Olympic marathon history. Way back in Greek history, 490 BC, there was a dude named Pheidippides. His job was to be a professional long-distance runner and messenger, since they didn't exactly have cell phones or telegrams or other ways to communicate at that time. So in a famous event, 490 BC, Pheidippides ran from 25 miles from the city of Marathon, Greece. Now you know where the name of the race comes from. He ran from there to Athens to bring the news to the Greek leaders that they had been victorious in this great battle over the Persian army. 25 miles. And what happened when he got there? He dropped dead. He grew faint, he lost heart, and he dropped dead. You might think, why would 25 miles kill somebody? Well, if you've ever seen me try to run, if I tried to run a marathon right now, I'd probably drop dead at the end of it too. But the rest of the story is, before he ran that 25 miles, he had run from Athens all the way to Sparta to ask the Spartan army to come help the Athenians, the Greek army, to fight off these Persians who were invading. The guys at Sparta said, that's a great idea, but we're kind of in the middle of a festival right now, so when the new moon comes and our festival's over, then we'll come help you in a few days. So he turns around and runs 150 miles back from Sparta back to Athens, runs another 25 miles up to back to the city of Marathon, and says, the Spartan army is coming, but they're not going to be here for a while, so you guys got to hold the fort. They'll come and help. So he's run 350 miles over a few days. And while the first 325 he did okay, the last 25 miles without stopping did him in. He grew weary. He literally, his heart failed. So his heart grew faint, and boom, he was dead. Interesting story. You might not have known that. Ladies, if you have a baby on the way, you're looking for a distinctive name for a son so he won't have the same name as anyone in their class, go with Pheidippides. There won't be many other guys named the Little Dipper in your class like that one. Anyway, moving on in Olympic history, 1896, modern Olympics, first modern Olympics ever held in Greece. They decided, hey, let's do this marathon race to commemorate the trip of Pheidippides from Marathon to Athens. So they did a race that was 25 miles long, exactly the same distance Pheidippides ran, in order to commemorate this great moment in Greek history. And the marathon distance was set at 25 miles. Right then. Now, some of you may know, well, that's not what it is now. It's a little longer. It's like 26.2 miles. Well, that's the next part in marathon history. 12 years later in London, the Olympics are held in London, Queen of London, Queen Alexandra, decides this is such a big event and it's so awesome, we need to have the royal family viewing it. So they had the start line on the lawn right in front of Windsor Castle so the royal children could look out the nursery windows and see it. They had the finish line in the Olympic Stadium right in front of the royal box, right like the 50-yard line, middle of the stadium, because she wanted all the runners to know that this race was being viewed by royalty. There are royals watching. It's such an important race, so do your best. So what's the analogy for us? Hey, we've just learned from Hebrews. There's all these famous people in Hebrews 11 who are watching you run your race. And most important, royalty, not just these heroes of the faith from the past. Jesus is watching, waiting for you at the finish line. So run your race well. There is royalty watching. Don't be lazy. Don't get off track. Don't just decide, I'm not interested anymore. There's royalty watching you run your race. So run your Christian race well. Moving on to Hebrews 12, verse 2. Next verse here. You could spend a whole hour just talking about this first phrase, but we're going to do our best at it. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. What does that mean? To look unto Jesus, fix your eyes on Jesus, turn your eyes to other things. You want to make sure that you're focused on the right thing as you're running your Christian life. And it's not very fun if you're in a race and you think you're following the right person and you get off course. And this has happened a couple times recently in marathon history. I'm going to put some other great sports history for you up. This last year in Venice, there was a big marathon in Venice, right? The Venice Marathon. Some rookie dude from Italy won it because the leaders got off track. The motorcycle cop who's leading them in the marathon race took a wrong turn. They ran a half mile off course. Then they realized it ran a half mile back, and they ran a 27.2 mile marathon. And this guy who was running the first marathon in his life, who happened to be Italian, won the Venice Marathon. Now, that made all the people of Venice and Italy very happy that one of their own sons won the marathon. It made these other runners pretty ticked off that they were led off course. They were the leaders, they were way ahead, and they didn't get the prize because they were following someone who didn't know where they were going. Same thing happened in Houston this last year, the Woodlands Marathon in Texas. Some rent-a-cop who was riding a motorcycle to lead the marathon took a wrong turn. Leaders got off course, somebody else won. So make sure that your eyes are fixed on Jesus and not somebody else who is leading you on the wrong course as you run your life. Don't try to model your life or follow the example of someone else who is going to take you off course. What does this mean to fix your eyes on Jesus? What other translations? What do they say about this? How else could we understand this? Jesus is our leader and our example. We're supposed to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, look to him, keep our eyes on him. I like the Amplified version for this little passage. It says, look away from all else that will distract us and focus our eyes on Jesus. And if you watch the runners in a race, you don't see them looking at the sidelines, waving to the spectators, you know, saying, oh, I think that's my Uncle Joe over there. I'd like to go wave to him. And hey, look over there. There's someone walking a dog, and I'm kind of a dog lover. I wonder, is that a golden doodle or a labradoodle or a double doodle? And while they're paying attention to that, they're stepping in a hole, spraining their ankle. Someone else is going by them. They may get tripped up and hit the deck because they're not looking where they're supposed to be looking. They have to be fixing their eyes on a goal, and that's to be following Jesus in their future. The next phrase in this verse says that Jesus, in this translation, it says he is the pioneer and perfecter of faith. King James renders this the author and finisher of our faith. Other translations, some say the one who starts, the initiator of our faith and the completer of our faith, kind of like the whole Alpha and Omega deal. Some translations have said he's the origin or the source of our faith as well as the ultimate goal of our faith. It's all about Jesus, focusing on him, living our life with him in mind. And then this verse goes on to say that Jesus, the author and perfecter or pioneer and perfecter of our faith, for the joy that was set before him, he endured. Hebrews 12, verse 2 still, for the joy set before Jesus, he endured the cross and sat down at the right hand of God. And as my daughter was reminding me last night, joy is a very powerful motivator. You know, that's probably one of the greatest motivations we have in life is the joy set before you. And I know this is true, and I know what's going on with this passage because it's very clear from other points in Scripture. Paul writes to the church in Philippi and the church in Thessalonica. He said, You are our joy and our crown. Knowing that you're following the Lord and we're going to be with you in heaven, man, that's my joy and crown. That's what keeps me in ministry, the joy of seeing other people following the Lord and being with me in heaven. When Jesus is on the cross, the guy next to him, the thief on the cross, turns over and says, hey, you've done nothing wrong. Remember me when you get to your kingdom. Jesus says, this day you're going to be with me in paradise. That was like a little energy boost for Jesus as he's finishing the worst part of his suffering on the cross. That's the joy before him, that others are going to be with him, just like for Paul, knowing that another church was doing well. That was his joy and his crown. How else do I know this? Well, I have a very practical illustration of this from my own life because, see, my wife, her name is Carol, and the meaning of the name Carol is Song of Joy. And when I was first starting to hang out with Carol, we dated a little bit at college. And then she went home to her house in the summer, and I was at mine. And there was 500 miles apart from us, okay? And back then, college was cheap enough that you could work hard in the summer and try to make enough money to pay your year in college. So I was working two or three jobs around Chicago, hustling all I could to make money to pay for my college stuff. But Carol's 500 miles away from me. And I really liked being with her. And it was great joy for me to be with her. And I was looking for opportunities, and when I get a weekend, not even a three-day or four-day weekend, but if I'd even have a Saturday and Sunday free where I didn't have to work that weekend, man, I was piling in the car, and as soon as I'm done with work, I'm hitting the road. And 500 miles in a little beat-up Toyota Corolla that had black vinyl seats, no air conditioning, in the Midwest, in the summer when it's 100 degrees and 90% humidity, and I'm driving 9 hours to get from Chicago to Nebraska, where she's at, to get to spend time with her. And yeah, the drive wasn't fun, and it was inconvenient, and it was painful, but it was so worth it to get to hang out with her for probably 36 hours, and then I'd pile back in the car, right, and drive my hot, sticky, sweaty car with no air conditioning another 500 miles back so I could be back at work, get some sleep Sunday night, get back to work Monday morning. But it was well worth it to establish a relationship so I could have a long-term relationship with Carol and enjoy my wife, my bride, who is the song of joy for me. So the deal is, for Jesus, did he have inconvenience? Yes. Was he willing to travel a long distance to give himself for us? Man, heaven to earth is way longer than Chicago to Nebraska, I'll tell you that. Chicago to Lincoln, Nebraska. He went a great distance, a great inconvenience of himself, for himself, so that he could be with us, not just for a weekend, or not just for 35 years, which my marriage has been to this point, or 50 or 60 years for some of you maybe in this room, but for eternity, so we could be with him. We are his joy. And for the joy set before him, his motivation was wanting to be with you guys and with us in heaven, and for us to be with him, not for a weekend, right? Not for 50 years, but for all eternity, to have a relationship and get to let us spend eternity with him. Man, that's some motivation. So that's the joy set before Jesus. That was his motivation that would help him endure while he's going through difficult times and suffering on the cross. And the last little part of that is saying, don't lose heart, right? Don't lose heart like somebody else did. Let's go to Hebrews 12, verse 3. Consider Jesus. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you won't grow weary and lose heart. The Greek word here is very interesting. My son, who's a Greek scholar, would be embarrassed of my pronunciation, but something like analogizomai, something like that. You guys can probably get it better than me. But the Greek word there is a combination of root words that we get two words from. Analyze, right? To do an analysis and really weigh something out, and logarithm, okay? That's the root of the word from which we use logarithm to do our exact calculations and difficult calculations. So what he's saying is, don't follow Jesus just because of emotions or because it gives you warm, butterfly, mushy-gushy feelings in your heart, or because Jesus' story of helping people kind of reminds me of puppy dogs and butterflies and warm summer days. Don't follow Jesus because of emotions. It's okay to have good emotions, but calculate it out. Analyze it. These people knew there was a historical Jesus, right? Even the Roman historian Josephus, who was not a Christian or of Jewish background, he documented the life of Jesus. He said there was this Jesus who was a leader and many people followed him. It's a historical event. These people lived through it. They knew that Jesus lived, and he's telling them, do the calculations. Analyze this. You know what Jesus went through. You know about his death and resurrection. Calculate it out. Analyze this. There's nothing in life of value as much as following Jesus. He endured so much for you, so you can endure for him. Don't grow weary and lose heart. Again, referring to Philippides at the end of his marathon. He kind of literally lost heart. Heart failure, dropped dead at the end of his race. He's saying, run your race well. Don't grow weary. Don't lose heart. So what does it really mean? Let's talk practical stuff. This all sounds well and good. Fixing your eyes on Jesus is a lovely phrase. It sounds like a lofty goal. What does it mean practically? How do I do that today? How do we know what that really means? And I love it when Scripture interprets Scripture, when Scripture is its own commentary on Scripture, because you don't have to worry, is this Dan's version or my interpretation or Pastor Jim's interpretation or Ryan's interpretation? When Scripture comments on Scripture and gives us an illustration that tells us exactly what this means, that takes all the guesswork out of it. And there is one character in Scripture that gives us a number of little snapshots through his life, or little short little scenes, if you would, from a movie deal, that tell us exactly what this means, what it means to fix your eyes on Jesus and what that does for your life, what it means to take your eyes off of Jesus and look elsewhere, and the consequences of that. And that's the Apostle Peter, one of my favorite characters in the Scripture. He reminds me a lot of me. Many times in his life, whatever pops into his head, he blurts it out immediately without thinking. He's a little impulsive. There's times an idea pops into his head and he just goes for it. Jesus is getting arrested in Garden of Gethsemane. His other disciples are a little upset, but they're scared. Peter whips out a sword, chops off the ear of the high priest's servant. Not a brilliant move, but hey, he's bold. He's courageous. He's going to go for it. He sees Jesus on the shore one time when they're fishing. The other disciples say, hey, that's Jesus there. They're all just looking at him. Peter dives in, swims all the way to shore, throws off his fishing garments, and swims to Jesus. He's a do-it-first guy and think later, and he's going to show us about what it means to fix your eyes on Jesus. First little snapshot from Peter's life, Matthew 14. You guys know this story well. They're on the Sea of Galilee, the disciples are. A big storm comes up. Jesus has stayed behind on the north shore, and he's going to walk across to where they're going and meet him. There's wind, there's waves, it's a rough night on the sea. The disciples are scared, they're not going to make it. Jesus is walking across the water, they see Jesus, and they're scared. They say, it's a ghost, we're going to die. And Jesus chirps in and says, chill out, boys, it's me. You're okay. And Peter, while the rest of the guys are hiding in the bottom of the boat and shaking with fear, Peter says, Jesus, if that's you, tell me to come out there. Jesus says, come on, Peter. And so Peter fixes his eyes on Jesus, and what does he do? He walks on the water. There's still storms around him. The wind is up. The waves are high. It's a nasty night. He's getting soaked, but he is fixing his eyes on Jesus, and he can just walk through life even with the storms raging around him. He still feels the consequence of the storm, right? The water's a little bumpy. There's wind blowing. He's getting soaked, but he is fixing his eyes on Jesus and succeeding in walking through the storms of life. Then he decides to look at the storms, and he gets so worried about the circumstances around him. He looks at the wind. He looks at the waves, and what happens? Down he goes, right? And that happens to me, too. You guys may have had it happen to you. When I fix my eyes on the storms of life around me, take my eyes off of Jesus and focus on the storms or difficulties of life, I go down. We all do when we take our eyes off of Jesus. Peter gives us a good example of what to do next. He doesn't bemoan the fact. He doesn't try to swim himself out of that situation. He utters my favorite prayer in the Bible. For those of you who think that every prayer has to be hours long and using flowery King James, herefore, therefore, wherefore, flowery English, Peter says three words. Lord, help me. Lord, save me. Boom, three words. Jesus does the bicep curl, pulls him back up. Next thing he knows, his eyes are fixed on Jesus. They're in the boat and they're smooth sailing. So if you're in that situation where you're focusing on storms, you're still going to feel the storm, but fix your eyes on Jesus and you will get through the storm that's there. When you focus on the storm and take your eyes off of Jesus, you're going down. Next vignette from Peter's life, next little snapshot, Matthew 17. This is called the Transfiguration. Peter, James, and John are with Jesus. They're up on a high mountain, probably Mount Hermon on the north part of Israel. Jesus goes a little bit away from them, and suddenly Jesus is there talking with Moses and Elijah. And the scripture says Jesus was transfigured, metamorphosized, glowing, bright. And Moses is representing the law, Elijah's representing the prophets. They're probably talking about how Jesus is fulfilling everything in the law and prophets. He's the ultimate fulfillment as he gets ready for his death and resurrection and crucifixion. Peter, bold guy that he is, impulsive guy, blurts out the first thing in his mind. He said, Jesus, it's so good we're here. We will build three booths, three little monuments, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. We'll get three statues here just to show that you are just as important as Moses and Elijah. Jesus, we knew you were a good teacher and a great guy, but I never knew that you were on the level of Moses and Elijah. This is awesome. We're here. We can document it for all eternity. And while he's saying this, the voice of the Father thunders from heaven. In my mind, I hear the James Earl Jones deep bass voice. And the voice from heaven knocks these guys to the ground. Peter, James, and John, boom, they're down. And the voice thundering from heaven says, this is my beloved son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. You got the echo effect going, right? And these guys are on the ground. And it says when they looked up, Moses and Elijah are gone. There's no one there but Jesus only. What's the Father saying? Moses is great. Elijah is good. He's a good guy. But this is Jesus. This is my son. Moses and Elijah pale in comparison to him. And don't get your eyes so fixed on spiritual leaders, past, present, or future, that would take your eyes off of Jesus. Don't get so fixated on Chuck Smith or Billy Graham or Mother Teresa or great historical Christian figures or even modern-day leaders in your life. I will tell you that I've seen people that get so focused on following one Bible teacher or one pastor that their eyes can get off of Jesus. You may be from this church. You may know some of our pastors here, and you may be in a tough spot in your life, and you might say, what should I do? I know, I'll be just like Jim. What would Jim do in this situation? He would go climb a mountain, and he'd have rappelling gear, and he'd go rappelling down the mountain, and then he'd climb to the top of Mount Shasta and sled down back and forth, or he'd be up on the top of the mountain where they're at this weekend with a guy snowboarding down Bachelor. That's what I'll do. That'll get me out of this problem. I'll be just like Jim. And Pastor Jim would say, hey, you know, if you want to learn to follow me as I follow Christ and learn about following Christ, that's fine, but you don't have to run my race and be just like me. Just follow the Lord. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. You might want to be just like Ryan and say, man, I'm in a tough situation. What would Ryan do? Well, I'd have to first learn to be a great guitar player and worship leader and be able to lead a large group of people in worship. And then I'd have to be a high school football coach because I can relate to teens real good and I know football so well, so I better go volunteer to school to be a football coach and then I'll be out of my problems. That's what I really need to do in life. And what Ryan would say is, don't do that. Follow me as I follow Christ. Yeah, learn to take a few examples from maybe from my life, from how I fell in Christ, but don't try to be just like me. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Run the race that you have before you, not my race. Next step ahead, Peter's denial. Luke 22, Jesus has been on trial at the high priest's house, and most of the disciples are hiding back in the upper room. Peter, bold guy that he is, he's going to stay with Jesus. He's still fixing his eyes on Jesus. And then he starts to get hit up by enemies. They start accusing him. You were with Jesus. I saw you. You were with him. Wait, you even talk like a Galilean. You must have been with him. Third guy says, hey, I was related to the guy whose ear you chopped off. I know you were there. Peter starts denying it vigorously. His eyes get off of Jesus and onto the enemies around him who are accusing him. And we all get times in life when there's enemies who are out to get us, or we have accusers. The Bible says Satan is the great accuser of the brethren, and there's some Christians that live their whole life focusing on Satan accusing them instead of fixing their eyes on Jesus, right? So at the end of this passage, after he denies Jesus the third time, the rooster crows, and it says Jesus looked right at Peter. Peter fixes his eyes on Jesus. They're lasered in, and Peter weeps bitterly and runs away from there in tears, because he knows he did it again. I did it again. I got my eyes off of Jesus. And this time I'm looking at enemies and those accusing me instead of fixing my eyes on Jesus. Last little passage, John 21. Jesus has risen from the dead. He's resurrected. He's been with his disciples some. Luke 24 tells us that Jesus has given specific instructions to his disciples. Stay in Jerusalem. Stay in this city until you're empowered with the Holy Spirit from on high. Peter kind of gets tired of waiting for Pentecost for the Holy Spirit. And Jesus hasn't quite ascended to heaven yet, and Peter decides, I'm going fishing. I like to do that. I'm a fisherman. That's who I am. I've always been a fisherman. Before I was a disciple, I was a fisherman. I like being on the water. I'm going fishing. Except Jerusalem to the Sea of Galilee, where he knew where best where to fish, that's 100 miles by roads now. If you're walking, you might be able to go a little straighter path in the roads. That's still over 80 miles. Say you walk 20 miles a day. That's still 4 miles walk just to go fishing. And when Peter decided to take his eyes off of Jesus and the instructions Jesus had given him to go back to his old habits, his old hobbies, what he knew before, his old haunts, his eyes get off of Jesus and he leads others astray. And all these guys, instead of being where they're supposed to be, are 80 miles off track and way off the line. But Jesus is graceful. He's a gracious God. So they're fishing. They fish all night. They catch nothing. One of the great miracles in the Bible, when they're asked, what have you been catching, boys? What have you been fishing? They say, we caught nothing. And no fisherman ever says that. Anyway, Jesus from the shore says, throw your nets on the other side. They bring in the nets. It's a huge haul. John elbows Peter and says, Peter, that's Jesus. No one else could do that. Peter throws off his fishing garb, dives in, swims to the shore. And there's Jesus with roasted fish broiled up for breakfast waiting for Peter. What Peter has been working all night to try to get on his own from going back to his old habits, his old hobbies, his old haunts, Jesus had for him the whole time if he would have just been fixing his eyes on Jesus. What's the message there? Don't take your eyes off of Jesus to go back to old habits, old haunts. Even don't let your vocation, your job, get in the way of following Jesus. That doesn't mean your job's not important. God has put you in your job for a place. If your job is stay-at-home mom raising kids or working with your hands or teaching kids in school, whatever the job the Lord has given you to do, the Lord says we're to do it heartily with all our might as unto the Lord, right? Maybe there's a couple jobs that would be hard to do that with if you're a mafia hitman or a drug dealer or into human trafficking. It probably would be hard to do that job heartily as unto the Lord. But for the rest of us, the job that God has given you, man, do it to his glory. Do it as best you can, but don't let that get in the way of following the Lord. Make sure you can still follow Jesus. Don't let your hobbies and past haunts get in the way of that. Finally, the last little few verses of John 21, Jesus is talking to Peter about what's ahead from him. He says, Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. Be a leader. Peter, do you even like me? Then feed my lambs. Tend to the church. Peter, be a leader in the church if you love me. And Peter kind of gets tired of this little inquisition while his eyes are fixed on Jesus. He said, how come you're all on me, Jesus? What about John? What about him over there? He takes his eyes off of Jesus, focuses on another disciple, and he starts talking about John's life and wanting to know what Jesus is doing in that person's life. And we too can get our eyes off of Jesus when we look at our peers. We can look at colleagues from work or neighbors or friends or even people from church, and we can say, Jesus, how come their life is so easy and mine is so hard? How come their kids are perfect and my kids are getting into trouble and, you know, they're not doing very well right now? Or how come they're in the same position I am or similar position, but they're getting promotions or a raise and I'm not? What's going on? And what Jesus says to Peter is the same thing he would say to us, is don't worry about John. Don't worry about other people and disciples. What I'm doing in their life is between me and them. You follow me. Peter, you fix your eyes on me. Now, it's great bookends for Peter's life, because when Jesus first called Peter, he was fishing, and Jesus said, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. That's the first thing Jesus ever said to Peter. The last thing Jesus said to Peter, as recorded in the scripture, is, Peter, you follow me. Don't look at other people. Fix your eyes on me. So a great example for us. I hope some of that can be practical for you and useful to you as you think about what it means for you to run your race, not my race or Jim's race or Ryan's race or somebody else, but the race that the Lord has given you, where he has put you. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Cast aside any extra weight that slows you down. Get rid of any sin that is habitually or chronically entangling you. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Run with endurance the race that's before you. Know that you're running before royalty. God bless you guys. If any of you want to talk about some of these things or get prayer for this, there'll be leaders and pastors up here. If any of you don't know Jesus and want to learn more about him, we're happy to share that with you. And let's pray, and then we'll be on our way. Lord, I pray your blessing on your body here today on Mountain Church. We pray that this day is not just a celebration because of Super Bowl or which team wins, if our team wins or watching all the crazy commercials and ads, but that we would be celebrating you and fixing our eyes on you as we run the race that is before us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, I know that you were totally blessed by the word, because the word of God is powerful and it changes us. And so I'm really glad you guys tuned in today. And if you want to continue to maybe hear more about the series that we're in, or you want to just check out some of the other teachings, feel free to go to mtnchurch.tv. And you can find all of our teachings posted there. But more importantly, man, I hope that you, if you're in the vicinity at all, you can come and join us live and come to our services. I'd love to meet you and pray with you. So God bless you, and I hope to see you soon.